Welcome to the number three talk in this special session of energy. And I hope I will get the view graphs. Okay. That's a special session. My name is Klaus von Klitzing, and I'm non-specialist in the field of general energy. Therefore, I asked only for a short contribution of 10 minutes, because I will focus on a special part topic, solar cells and solar energy, because I was working my whole life in semiconductor physics, so I know something about semiconductors which form the basis of solar cells, and therefore I will concentrate on this. And the sun is also the logo, more or less, of our conference here. You see the sun on the front page of our program, and there's also the Earth, and we learned already on Friday that in 5 billion years, no life on Earth. So we can ask the question, why? Because the sun will be a red giant and everything will disappear. So in certain way, life on Earth is not very sustainable, but this will be in billion years. And here the question is, what happens in 10 years, in 1,000 years? And we have to concentrate on the homemade problems and not in the nature, because the nature, you know, that really in long term, in billions of years, there will be no life on Earth. But we heard already from Lisa Kaltenegger, there are some thousands of new worlds, so we have still billions of years to think about this, to communicate with aliens, to transfer our knowledge on other planets. And I will include one view graph, which has nothing to do directly with energy. So we have to educate the aliens about what was the Earth. And there's something even which is more stable than life on Earth. That's the universal language of science. And I gave once a talk, and you can see the film Universal Language, to demonstrate that we have also something which is more stable than life on Earth. And on lunchtime, I discovered that many scientists, they don't know that we will have a big change, that we will use something which is very stable in the future in a new global system of measurement units. And I give then Bill Phillips a chance to ask a question, because this is his topic, that we will have in 2 years' time, and most of the scientists perhaps do not know this, we will have a new global system of measurement units which are independent of humans and independent of the Earth. And just this one slide, that we had local units in former times where we used the human, and in the Bible you can find then cubits and ells, food grains. These were local units which were different in different parts of the world. And then for 150 years now we have global units, and we believe that the Earth is something very special, and we used, you know, the rotation of the Earth for the time and the dimension of the Earth for the length unit. And now in 2018 we will have universal units, which will be universal fixed values for constants of nature. And these are the stable units in the future, independent of humans and Earth. So this was just this one picture to remind you that there's something going on in the next 2 years which has something to do with constants of nature. And for example, our kilogram, if Paris disappears in billions of years, where we have the prototype, we will still have a kilogram based on fundamental constant, on the Planck constant. Okay, but now to science and sustainability. My pragmatic definition is that we have to ensure a desirable planet for the next three generations. This is a near future goal. And okay, we can discuss already what is a desirable planet. And I will quote United Nations, the Secretary General. Energy. Energy is a golden thread that connects economic growth, increased social equity, and an environment that allows the world to thrive. So therefore, energy is the driving force for our future. And another quote, energy, and mainly electrical energy, is most valuable energy, is not only the driving force for economic wealth, necessity for a decent living in a world with increasing population. And we were lucky enough, all of us, to live in this world of increasing energy. I was born at this time, and I enjoyed wonderful life, this is increasing availability of energy, but we know at the expense of the next generation. And we know 2/3 of world's electrical energy used today is generated by the burning fossil fuels. 2/3 of the energy. And we know the consequences. And I think it's impossible that we destroy a reservoir of coal, oil, natural gas within some 100 years, which was built up within more than 70 million years. So the time constant and all these discussions are always the important part. And all of you know this picture. In my life, we increased by 50% our CO2 content in the air. And all we know is that we want to limit this, but if I look at this curve and I ask the scientists, what is the extrapolation, I see no chance to have an asymptotic behavior at 450 parts per million for CO2, even 550 may be difficult to reach. So we need really the radical change, I think, in the next 5 years. Now, the problem is for most of the non-scientists that we don't see CO2, for example. And so here is a camera which really measures the CO2. And if you could see on the street our CO2 emission, and many scientists, even physicists, don't know that 1 liter of gasoline burns to 2.3 kilograms of CO2, a huge amount, that we deposit this in our air, I think we have to educate more the public about these emissions. So these are the black spots in the world now for our CO2 emission. And this is much more, this is 100 times more than the plastic we heard yesterday in the oceans. So the CO2 in the air, this is one of our problems. And I like this picture because many outsiders, they don't know that our solar energy is huge. Here is a picture where the world energy consumption is represented by the volume of this small earth shown in this picture. And we know that the natural reservoirs, they are much bigger, so they represent the reservoir of energies. They are 30-100 times bigger than our annual need. So there is a reservoir, but they are depleted with time, these natural reservoirs. And the solar systems, every hour the sun beams onto the earth more than enough energy to satisfy global energy needs for an entire year. So a huge amount, and all the other ones, the wind, the biomass, the hydro, these are secondary results of this sun emission. And as a physicist, I know that I can transfer sun energy, the photons, directly in electricity. But what is the problem already? Still at the beginning of the century, the photovoltaic electricity was nearly nothing, 0.1% or less of this, of world energy use. And there was always the statement, too expensive, no chance, no future. But I will show this has changed. And if you look at these predictions, they were always pessimistic. So I have here the prediction photovoltaic capacity in gigawatts, they extrapolated the extrapolation from 2002, they expected very small increase up to 2020. And then every year they increased this prediction. And you see 2010, 2012, 2015, they always increased the prediction for the use of photovoltaic. But the historical development was always faster than the prediction. And even in the future, we will have predictions which will be higher than the past. And if you look really at the total world energy, electricity generating capacity, you see the black line, that's the world total, and then the photovoltaic solar energy, the total one, is increasing at present with a growth rate of 35%. And if one looks at this picture, they say, okay, there's only in the near future we will reach the black curve. But this is always the danger of the logarithmic scale is still only few percent. So we need still a factor of 100 to reach really the 100% goal. Now, if we sum up all the renewable power generations, the wind, mainly. Then we have 5% increase in 2015 for all the renewable power generation, and now 23% of total electricity generation we have covered with this renewable energy. So we saw already this picture that the price is always very important. The module prices for photovoltaic cells reduced drastically. And there are a lot of fluctuations. In 2008, more silicon wafers were used for cells than for microelectronic devices. The big market started in this century. And in 2008, we had an increase in the prices because there's a shortage of semiconductor material. Then we had the Chinese production lines. Now we have an overproduction of panels, so that the price is below this smooth curve, the smooth green curve. But the most important point is that we reach the band of coal natural gas costs with photovoltaic. Exactly at this time, we are cheaper with photovoltaic than the other production methods. And therefore, you can understand this picture, the red picture, this is the decrease in the cost of the solar panels, and the blue one, the global solar panel installations. It's rapidly increasing now, and the price for the solar panel per watt went down in August this year to $0.447. Now, the backbone of the mass production, we saw the different materials in semiconductor physics. Silicon is still the backbone for all the photovoltaic. So I have here a picture, monocrystalline silicon, multi-silicon film. 90% is covered by silicon, crystalline silicon. But there are many other materials, and we don't know whether other materials will be more successful. We saw, Stephen showed a picture with cadmium telluride is more adjusted to the spectrum of the sun. Maybe that this will be important for the future. I just show you this general picture about the best cells, the best efficiency. In the central part, the blue area, the efficiency of some around 20% is still silicon. The very, very best one are gallium arsenide C5 materials, but there are new materials coming up, perovskites, here cadmium telluride, copper indium, gallium selenide. There are a lot of still open questions, but it depends always finally on the price on the market. If you have very special application, mainly space for satellites, then we're using the expensive C5, and the highest efficiency is at present 46%, and these are very special devices which cover the whole spectrum of our sun with three different materials covering the different light spectrum of the sun. And then one can concentrate the radiation so that we have this high efficiency of 46% for these solar cells. But we are still at the very beginning. If you want to have finally 15% share of the total electricity generation, we have to increase the production. So this is still at present our situation, and this is a question of investment and of the growth of installing silicon for photovoltaic energy. And this is always the question of investments. Now, even if we increase this amount of photovoltaic energy, we cannot cover the increase needed in the future. I have here the picture for the next 6 years. The dark areas is the electricity generation growth for the next years. And the green one is the growth which is available from photovoltaic and from renewable energy. And we can just cover the increase by 60%. So we cannot really stop it in the present situation if the growth of production of electricity with photovoltaic is at the same way as at present. So we have no simple solution. We should use all kinds of energies to cover this demand. So the summary, which is a little bit biased in favor of solar energy, first of all, efficiency measures, and secondary, renewables such as wind, biomass, will assist the energy transition to come. But ultimately, the greatest promise lies in the combination of large-scale solar power plants and small-scale building-integrated solar energy use. And if I hear all the discussion what will happen in the United States, I have also some positive message. I saw this publication, Trump's coal revival plan wouldn't work. Clean energy tech is already cheaper. And economy is always a driving force. And therefore, I think clean energy has a good chance for our future. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this positive outlook. And yeah.